Thank you. Well, I want to start off too, just to add to your bios, is like what, you know, we can go down the line again. What got you into the work? What brings you, what is the personal motivation that brings you to where you've, you know, gone, the decisions you've made about your career and your current project? Well, yeah, Ryan, right? Okay. Yeah.
Well, as I mentioned just now, I have a long history with entrepreneurship and with my parents. My mom, when I was a little kid, banded together with a lady down the street, and they would go in and clean people's houses, and she put me down on the floor to play while they did that. And so I witnessed this growing up. They would share the profits from cleaning people's houses. And then I even took on micro-entrepreneurial activities as a kid and hustled, sold people pencils, and, you know, taught them how to use computers and graphic design and web development, and that started to become all the rage. And then I went off, you know, given my background, we didn't have a lot of money for me to go to school, so I had racked up an enormous amount of student debt in order to go to college, and I went off into investment banking to pay some of that debt down. And I got to learn all the ins and outs of the system, so like Arno, I'm a recovering banker. And I came out of that in the mortgage downturn to really think about what I wanted to do. I thought my family and my education were the two things that were most important things to me. And I pursued an opportunity to work on a higher education startup that was a nonprofit and for-profit joint venture. And in that, saw all of the challenges in higher ed. And if you fast forward a few years, Optima Business Bootcamp really is a school of lifelong learning for entrepreneurs. And in those challenges in higher ed, looking at for-profit models that were bringing in students that really weren't ready for the programs and churning them out with a lot of debt. And then in the nonprofit model, schools with really great missions but not a lot of resources. And so the cooperative model really brought the two of those things together and created a situation where everybody could have ownership.
Yeah, and Robbie, in your mind, how does this relate to sharing seeds also, just to add that on?
Well, we should own things that belong in our cities. And if you think about all of the businesses in the city, they're owned by people. And a lot of them, small businesses, got started through business incubators and accelerators and other entrepreneurship programs. And the way that we thought about this is, well, if we can build wealth through ownership in our business, what if we could build wealth through sharing that ownership across all of our businesses? So the fundamental premise in what we're doing is that each one of the people who go through our accelerator programs has an opportunity to contribute a piece of their business to the accelerator and literally invest in each other. And so, you know, you own a business, I own a business, we own each other's business through this cooperative structure.
Hey, yeah, love it. Yasi, okay, so 30 seconds.
Yeah, really quickly, I guess the reason I'm here, I learned about climate change when I was a young teen, and I realized we should do something about it. So that quickly turned into realizing our environmental circumstances are intricately related to our economic systems. And that put me on a path of going to UC Berkeley and eventually making it to the Law Center, and focusing in on worker co-ops as a way to fundamentally transform our economic systems to make it work for people and to make it work for the planet. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah.
Right. So it's interesting, now we're at the beginning of 2018, and 10 years ago we were just like in the middle of the mess of the financial crisis. So I happened to be a bank executive at the time, and we were determining what do we finance, and like local businesses, food, and especially agriculture, none of the bankers really understand this, so we didn't really do very much there. None of the big banks actually do we a lot of financing in the essentials of life. And so after some introspections, I found out I'm actually a lifelong eater. Not only that, I'm actually also found out and going in history, I'm also coming from a line of lifelong eaters. There's probably, so there's something there. And so...
Wow, me too.
So through a lucky string of events, I turned out to be what is now considered to be an ambassador, although family background, I definitely don't come from a background of money. And then I'm looking at communities, like shared cities now, related to this event. Every bank has like community banking on their banner, BFA, Wells Fargo, or any of the big ones. But if we see what communities do from a sharing perspective, we're starting basically with the concept of shared fate. You try to get to this place tonight, you saw like how shared traffic, shared mess in the city. But usually we are like takers of the shared fate and not makers of the shared fate.
Right.
And if I look at cities, you have, usually there's one class who funds and invests the businesses into existence. And then the rest of us are invited to please be loyal customers of them and bring our money there that some other people basically created into existence. And that is quite an absurd dichotomy in terms of like shared existence, shared fate in a city, and that's how, that's why we created basically Credibles and other shared community investing mechanisms that we probably will be talking a little bit more about.
Yes, I mean, I'm sure you're too.
For me, I guess maybe two things. One, I'm Canadian, I was born and raised in Canada, and I think there's maybe a socialism, it's not a bad word there, so there's maybe a different cultural idea around sharing. Two, I'm an architect, so I live very precariously, so I'm very interested in more equitable ways to distribute resources in the city, because being someone in design disciplines, we are not in that slide. We're in the 3.6 billion slide, not the 8 on the left slide. But my current research here in San Francisco, done with my colleague Dante Steingler, is really looking at communes and co-living typologies, and we're trying to document a lot of the communes from the 60s, but also the current ones, as a way of understanding where co-living can go today and how people form their politics away from market structures.
Right, yeah, and co-living is like, this Bay Area is like the starting place and the most co-living communities in the world here in the Bay Area. Yeah. I want to go to Yossi, because we did that first policy guide together. It's been a few years, I think it was 2013. And you were the main person on the job and did a great job. And so you've been working at SELF for those years and before. And I just wanted to see how your thinking about sharing cities has evolved since then, and what do you see as the significance of sharing cities? What does it mean to you?
Well, like I said to Neil earlier, I've honed in on one element of the sharing city, because sharing cities spans everything from housing, to energy, to food systems, to work, to how we interact with each other. So thankfully, I've specialized in it more than than just the broad spectrum.
Way to stay on message, by the way, that's good.
So, but I think, I can talk more about worker co-ops and how those fit in, but the Sustainable Economies Law Center sees this as a really functional framework for a lot of the work that we do, fundamentally to increase community control of our resources to make them sustainable and locally run. And again, that spans all those different areas of what makes a city.
Yeah, thank you. And Raj, I want to ask you a similar question. You're an architect, and you have this experimental think tank, and so when you hear those words in sharing cities, what does it mean to you? Like, how does it fit into your theoretical intellectual kind of background?
I guess it feels a bit like a buzzword. I think the kind of history of cities has been a history of sharing, and it's maybe something we just forgot about in the last 100 years. I think that's the whole reason cities came together, is to realize, you know, we're much bigger and better than what we could do individually. And we industrialized around things to share and, you know, go beyond our carrying capacity as a globe. So I don't think there's anything new to sharing in cities. I think maybe it's rebranded more recently. Maybe we forgot more recently that this is, you know, at the core of what a city is. I think the ways that we're thinking about sharing, though, and I think, you know, Yasi, you said it with climate change, there are certain collective projects that need to be addressed. And we know that those elephants in the rooms are getting worse and worse, and our inability to address them kind of points to the possibilities of collectivity, and part of collectivity just comes to the base unit of, do you know how to share, do you know how to work collectively and together on something?
Right, yeah, that's really interesting too, that, you know, thinking about the history of sharing, and, you know, it's what humans do, and it's what makes us, one of the things that makes us distinct in the animal kingdom, and maybe, you know, that buzzword having to, like, bring the idea back speaks to how much we've forgotten, how much we need to,
so,
right,
yeah.
Share, right? And so, you know, if you were to influence this movement, what would you do? What would you bring to it? And how, you already are in a way influencing it. Just,
well,
if you were the movement strategist, like.
I guess, you know, my peers here are much more savvy with the economics of sharing and not sharing, and why, you know, there's certain pressures to not share. And I think for me personally, it would really be about understanding how we live on a basic level at home, because that's where a lot of your habits form at a very young age, and the context around those. And I guess in a more contemporary way, a lot of the things that we consider sharing right now in today's economy, try to create, say, guidelines for actual share space. So, for instance, in San Francisco, in a co-living arrangement, there's not a clear guideline of how much shared space there should be versus private space for a co-living scenario. So you can ask yourself, is this about bringing people together, or is this about commodifying land in a more efficient way, right? And I think those two things, unless there's sort of guidelines or policies to ensure that sharing is an equitable thing, it could easily be something that is used to commodify further, and I guess accelerate or deepen some of the crises that you pointed out earlier.
Yeah, that cheery thing I shared with everyone. It's interesting, in, you know, the history of sharing. We were founded in 2009, and you know, the first mission is to raise awareness, but that has a limit, like, because you can raise awareness and you can advocate for, like, behavior change, right? You can give people tools, you know, how-tos, information, which we do. But if their environment is not structured, even their physical environment, you know, is not structured a way to foster sharing and connectedness with other people, it's just not going to happen. You know, it has to be made. Also, you have to have the mindset and also the means. Right? It's got to be easy to do.
I thought it reminded me that this term sharing and sharing economy has been completely co-opted from what it originally meant and what it should mean. And in having conversations like this over the years, I've started to ask, sharing what? Sharing wealth, sharing information, sharing risk, sharing space, what are you sharing? I think fundamentally the who has power and who owns these things makes a big difference, and that's sort of a lens to carry with you when you're talking about sharing and sharing space.
Yeah, we did this story called Owning is the New Sharing. The Yes Magazine republished it and had, I think, a better headline, which is, you know, owning together is the new sharing, right? And that was helped kick off a whole movement around platform cooperatives, where it's a sharing economy platform approach to providing a service combined with a cooperative governance and ownership model. And that also has, I think, big implications for cities. And that leads me to ask Ronnie about, you know, why you chose the cooperative structure versus the traditional structure for entrepreneurship. You spoke to it a little bit. I'd like you to go deeper.
Yeah, and in the current environment, there's two major structures out there for entrepreneurship programs. You have incubators and accelerators that have been started as seed-funded accelerators, where they, you know, take in capital from other people, high net worth individuals, organizations, and put that capital to use by investing in businesses and taking them through a really highly selective process and a weed out process. And so they're taking a, you know, a 5% or even a 10% ownership stake in those businesses. And when those businesses exit, they, you know, that money goes to the 1% or 5% who actually own the fund itself. And then we also have entrepreneurship programs that are nonprofits, and they have wonderful missions and are doing wonderful work in the community. But, you know, in times like this, you know, since the mortgage crisis and, you know, kind of the philanthropic money is starting to fade away. And even now in this administration, the government funding is starting to fall away from those types of programs. And so they're constantly scrambling for money in order to really, you know, realize the potential of their programs. And so, you know, with this structure, we're actually, you know, creating a scenario where the entrepreneur pays into it. And they also get to contribute an equity stake in their business. But all of that, you know, is to pay for the service that they're providing, which is a really deep level of service to help them get their business going and ultimately get it funded. And in this structure, they actually get to own the accelerator. And so that really disrupts this model of either the exit returns going to the 1% or having to really scramble to get philanthropic money. And so, and it gives ownership to the people who are starting the businesses rather than having it dispersed to high net worth individuals or not having ownership in something that they've contributed to as far as the community of the entrepreneurship program. So if we want to talk about entrepreneurship as a means for wealth creation, this actually compounds their wealth creation. So you create wealth through your own business and create wealth through other people's business who are part of the community.
Yeah, and wealth in that context is shared.
Yeah, it
right?
is shared wealth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what we should be shooting for, especially these days. And it's interesting too, around the world, all these cities have these like tech incubator or tech accelerator programs. So they're like, if I was a taxpayer in the city that did that, I'd be furious, because it's like, why should my tax dollars be used to help concentrate wealth more and make the wealthy even wealthier,
mm-hmm.
right? That makes no sense at all. So, I mean, this is more like what I'd like to see more of in cities, and also just like civic incubators, not a civic accelerator,
totally.
Right? You know,
mm-hmm.
to like strengthen our democracy and our civic culture.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is the kind of stuff cities should be doing. I want to ask Yasi about to what can cities do to help develop more co-ops? And you've been involved in an effort in Oakland, so let's hear about that.
Yeah, cities can do a lot, and actually during this, given the wealth inequality, income inequality that's been raised a couple times already, and another really huge economic problem that less people are aware of is the silver tsunami. I don't know if folks in the room have heard of that. I see some nods. Basically, baby boomers own the majority of businesses in the U.S. that have employees, and they're all retiring within the next 10 years. It's pretty scary because most of these people don't actually have succession plans for their businesses either. What that means is trillions of dollars are going to be changing hands within the next 10 to 15 years. And this is a huge opportunity. Well, it's a big risk for losing local legacy businesses, losing name and character, and losing really good local jobs, or local jobs. And it's also an opportunity to really shift this to worker ownership, have health workers buy out these businesses, turn employees into owners, start to build equity and wealth, and not just look at income. So I think that's a huge opportunity, and so do a lot of cities. Cities like New York City, Madison, Minneapolis, Philadelphia, Austin, have all started to look at co-ops as an economic development tool. I'm working in the city of Berkeley right now. We were working in the city of Oakland, but we sort of put that on hold because the time is right in Berkeley to really ramp up our campaign. But the city of Berkeley is considering adopting the first ordinance of its kind. It's extremely comprehensive. It goes beyond what cities like New York City have done, which is incredible. They've already given $8 million to worker co-op development since 2014. This year alone, they're giving over $3 million to co-op development. They have big purses there.
It's a start, at least, right?
Yeah, no big deal. It's been a struggle to get other cities like Oakland and Berkeley to put up money, but they are interested in doing a lot of other creative things, and money's still on the table. We're still negotiating that. A few of the major things that we're pushing for are, one, solve the problem of lack of technical assistance. You know, if you're a small business, at least you can go to the city and get information about how to get a license, how to navigate permitting, and also, you know, be directed to various services for legal advice, financial help. When it comes to worker co-ops, cities don't know what they are, and they're certainly not able to point you to resources that already exist in this community. So the city of Berkeley would be required to start to put up on their website all the resources that are available in the Bay, which, by the way, the Bay Area is the biggest ecosystem of worker co-ops in the country, if you didn't know that. So the resources are there, so the city would be sort of convening that. Two, the city would be an anchor institution, and the anchor institution model is one where cities, hospitals, universities recognize their buying power and actually set their purchasing and contracting policies to reflect their values. So the city of Berkeley would create an incentive for worker co-ops to contract and sell their goods to the city itself. And the third and most exciting for me is that the city would be doing active outreach to businesses that they know will be retiring in the next 5 to 10 years. They'll be doing active outreach and also teaching them about conversion and connecting them to resources for actually having those conversions happen so that they can sell to their workers and keep their legacy alive. Small business owners worked on creating a living business and would like them to succeed even after their retirement. There's been some successful conversions already. Berkeley, Urban Ore in Berkeley has already converted to worker ownership. It's a much loved, basically junkyard where you can go and get everything you want. And also Slice of New York Pizza in San Jose, and there's gonna be more and more conversions happening. And actually conversions are the largest growth area for worker co-op development in the US right now. So hopefully that trend continues.
Yeah, that's great. It's like, you know, Ronnie, you know, talks about a new way to get into business and how that can spread wealth, and this conversion is a way of business owners exiting in a way that spreads wealth. So that's really interesting. And I want to go to you, Marta, too, because you're the ex-banker and investor in some really cool projects. And you took me to one of your investments, actually, to eat, and we did that, you know, ancient practice, human practice of eating together. I'm wondering how you're thinking about the role of investors in the sharing state. How would you do things differently?
I mean, first of all, I love the co-op examples that and the momentum that is building. All what that has in common is actually distribute the creation power and who calls the shots, basically in the participants in a city. I mean, basically turns shared fate into a participation sport.
Right.
So now money comes into the picture. Let's just ask a question here. So who is a fellow investor in the audience? I didn't think so. So who is a fellow eater in the audience? Okay, so we got a few. I actually wanted to also address the mystery what edible credits are and how we are taking it. Our tagline is, if you eat, you're an investor. If you eat, you're an investor. So first we want to shift the perspective, who is actually an investor. So bringing basically the hurdle down. The way, and I can quickly describe how this works, is the way regular people can invest in local businesses, and we're like right now on the food side, is by prepaying your future purchases at the business in advance. You have a tab at the business, which we call credibles, edible credits, that you eat down over the weeks and months to come, as opposed to at your bar where you pay the tab at the end before you leave. You basically pay a tab in advance. And it's kind of a loan that you give to the business owners, to the entrepreneur, except the entrepreneur pays you back in goods and services, in smoothies, eggs, bread, or grass-fed beef. If you will, don't try that with your bank. There's only so many gluten-free muffins that they can eat. But a community basically can absorb, can be paid back in their goods and services, and then strengthening the relationship between community members and its businesses. And it also cuts both ways. Not everything gets financed, because people will only pay up and pay for something that A, their taste buds approve, that they're willing to eat in the future, and where they have trust that the business will be around, and they know something about the business practices that they would want to get behind it. But it's basically regular people, like we have in a great grocery store in just north of the bridge here, Sausalito. Non-GMO, all organic since the beginning, gave Whole Foods a run for their money. They're like hundreds of families who basically prepay their tab, and they're run on a cushion of $500,000 of working capital. They were first-time entrepreneurs. No bank would like give them a time of the day and approve a loan application, if you will, and so. But the community approved that. Okay. We call that community underwriting. And so that it turns into a participation sport. And if you read, you're an investor. So I'll ask the question again before we move on. It's like, who is an investor in the room?
Yeah, everyone.
So, okay, so we'll, I think this is a healthy change of perspective. How can we take ownership of the funding and where our money goes, as opposed to dropping our money at the bank and then hoping that the bank makes the right decision, the bank underwriters make the right decision what needs to be funded in your community.
Yeah, we have a case study in the book about the public bank of North Dakota. Actually the tax dollars, the whole budget of the state is put in the state bank, which then the state loans off of for community-based projects in the state, and then the profits on that banking go into the state treasury for all the social programs, etc. So you know, finance can be a huge lever for sharing the city and for sharing wealth. You know, the impact.
Yeah. But one thing, even if you have like a bank institution, and no matter how it's owned, you still then need to have somebody at the bank who makes that underwriting decision and reads the business plan, as opposed to knowing people who work there, eating their products, being a community participant. So that's still, so this is wisdom of the crowd applied to investment decision versus institutional investors. When I was in bank, I had like professional underwriters, of course, working for our unit, who get like loan applications, and usually the loan applications are rated, by the way, two or 300 miles away from the business that's actually applying for a loan in a windowless cubicle floor,
right.
They're looking at their loan application, scoring it against some algorithms and send it back to the bank manager, branch manager to give a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
Right.
Those underwriters don't know anything what the community likes, what the community really needs. I wish when I was still in that profession, I actually had community intelligence. I could look into community expertise. I could look into people's minds, what they actually want to be buying in the future. But
right. We
are the freaking community. We know what we want, so we'll make that commitment. Yeah. And once we actually get behind it, a business, by committing to something, we actually turn into activist investors, because once we make a commitment, we actually want that they are successful. And so we have seen in many cases that then the people who made that commitment bring their birthday parties and the out-of-town visitors to this business, because now they really want it to succeed. And that is basically the shared fate, and we're in it together, like really applied to on a very practical term.
Yeah, that's right. That's how I got to your restaurant. What's the one you've invested in? It's in San Francisco. What's the name of it again?
You're talking about Hillside Supper Club, right?
Or Millennial, was it?
And the Perennial? Oh, yeah, Perennial is like, it's fairly new. It's like one of they got like the most sustainable restaurant in the U.S. award, because they make a complete connection between what you eat and how it affects climate change.
So
this goes a little bit beyond the scope of this panel, but basically people say, I'm investing in this restaurant, and I've never invested in restaurants, I usually leave that to the rich dentist. This is a restaurant who makes commitments to serving bread and serving beer that is made from grains that are perennials versus annuals. And just on a little side note, perennials have 5 times as long roots in the soil as annual grains, and so they absorb way more carbon, like 5 to 10x of the carbon out of the air, and that is actually the only thing how we will ever reverse climate change and carbon particles in the air, by actually getting them back into the soil where they belong. But I digress. But this is basically a customer investor and customer funder can take that into an account, versus this, the carbon sequestration and how long are the roots of the grains of that beer that they're serving. No bank
is gonna
underwriter about. Will ever look at these type of effects and see it's like, okay, we should put our money there.
Right.
But as an eater, you learn about it, the waiters explain to you softly, and all of a sudden you know something about the root length of grains. It's like, what the heck did I know when I was a banker about these things?
I knew I would learn something tonight with you guys. That's awesome. And the food there was really excellent.
Oh, yeah. It's perennial. It's half a block off from Market Street on 9th Street.
So one more question, and then we're going to take it to the audience. Raj, so back to you. Let's take it back to the earth, to the ground. And an architect, how can the built environment of the city, the way it's designed and patterned, help us to share?
That's a good question to try to answer in a minute. I think there's several factors. One is infrastructure, shared things that we use. I think some cities have more culture of shared use. Whether that's mass transit or use of libraries and so forth. I think that reminds us of the collectivity and where our tax money goes. I think density, I think there is a question about people living closer together, typically interact more with each other and break down certain barriers and are more likely to share things across households and so forth. I think for me in California and in the Bay Area, there is a culture of home ownership. Much more than condos or apartments, and I think that's a cultural thing. That people see a plot of land and a house and see that as something that is both an investment but also lives into a kind of cultural myth that they've been socialized into, and I think those are trickier things to change, because I think you can change the environment but that may not change cultural habits right away. So I think there's sort of a, just like all these kind of projects there, experiments which slowly start changing people's habits, or they know that there's other things out there, other ways that things can be done. I would say cities are like that. So every experiment spatially that we can do to show a new co-working space or a new type of co-living space, and to also change stigmas around that. And one thing we found in our research on, say, communes is that there's a particular cultural stigma about them of the 1960s and whatever you may associate with the original movement, that the new movement is trying to change, and it's more kind of branded towards young professionals. So how do you actually kind of change cultural stigmas and create new cultural myths for people? And I think that really just happens in very simple ways by the kind of spaces we interact in, the spaces we grow up in, and that hopefully will slowly change culture. I think we have higher battles in places. We were just talking about Houston earlier, like places like Houston or Atlanta that are very kind of horizontally dispersed as cities, because they require private car ownership often. There's a clear culture there of single family homes and so forth, and the list goes on and on. And so I think trying to remind people of the benefits of living close together or living together is probably the biggest thing that we're trying to do in our research.
Yeah, cool. Awesome, so let's open up.